courage that these young men had to show to go to war. And notice I've been at great pains not to try and glorify war, because every soldier I ever meet, anybody who's been through these situations always talks about how appalling and horrible it was and how they'd never want to go through it again. And I'm sure that's what our next guest would probably say. Alan Sparks, I'll let him tell his own story and I'll let him explain what this is all about tonight. But it takes my breath away to read what he did and what he achieved so selflessly in an act of courage, an ordinary man doing an extraordinary thing. Please clap your hands for an amazing Australian.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it is quite a phenomenal honour for myself and my fellow recipients to be here tonight. To Spiro and to Terry and to Anna, Paul, and to the Findex group, the invitation to participate tonight is probably a once-in-a-lifetime experience. And as we know, we are unveiling something very shortly, which is very hard to describe the level of pride that I have, and I'm sure my fellow recipients have, in what has been done. I would suggest that most of you in the room have no idea what a Cross of Valour is. I would suggest that most of you have some idea about what the Australian Honours and Awards system is. That's our current system of decorations for military and civilians. This was a change in our imperial system in 1975, and all the new Australian awards were then instituted. The Cross of Valour replaced the George Cross, and as you will see in the image which we're just going to put up, it has the words "For Valour," which is identical to the Victoria Cross, which has "For Valour." The maroon in the ribbon is identical to the Victoria Cross maroon ribbon. So it became the highest bravery decoration in Australia. So military awards are the gallantry awards, where civilian are bravery decorations. So since 1975, 40 years ago, there have been 5 of these medals awarded. And the first of these medals was awarded to Mr. Darryl Tree from South Australia, and Darryl is here tonight. Darryl's award was the benchmark for all subsequent Cross of Valour awards to be made. And when you read the citation of what Darryl did to receive his award, you will be in awe. This man was electrocuted 3 times. He died once to try and save the life of a man, another man, a fellow friend of his, and a very young boy. The last awards were made to 2 exceptional men, Tim Britton, who is here tonight from Western Australia, and Mr. Richard Joyce. When the bombings occurred, Tim and Richard repeatedly went into the burning buildings to save fellow Australians. Mr. Victor Westo was the second recipient of the Cross of Valour, and Victor was in a shopping centre when an armed robbery took place. Victor thought that one of the security guards had been murdered, and in a desperate and phenomenally brave attempt to identify the offenders, took off after them, and was continually rammed by them, was continually shot at and shot by these armed offenders. And the level of determination that he had to try and seek justice for the man who he had believed was murdered is simply extraordinary. And I think that we now have quite a little bit of synergy in regards to the story we've heard tonight, where an investigative journalist spent so much time and gave so much of himself to find the truth about something. And Ross, I may say on behalf of the Cross of Valour recipients, that your level of determination would make any hardened detective proud for what you have achieved. And you have captured the essence of Australians, Australian men and Australian people, and put that on display for our nation to be so proud of. And I cannot thank you enough for what you've done. Thank you. Thank you. So how did we get to be here? Well, another outstanding Australian journalist was given a story to write about some people who also hadn't received much recognition and were little known in this country. And a very dear friend of ours, Mr. Ray Martin, who's here tonight, was working for 60 Minutes. And he contacted me to say, Al, I've read the story about you and the other recipients of the Cross of Valour. We'd like to do a story on you. Now, Ray and his crew then travelled us around Australia to interview the recipients and told our story on 60 Minutes. And that was a formation of an exceptional relationship that we are also proud to share with having Ray Martin as one of our closest and dearest friends. And we are eternally grateful to you, Ray, for telling our stories and bringing something to Australia that hadn't been heard of too much before. That relationship then extended to, if they have the next slide, please. The five Cross of Valour recipients being together for the first time ever, and that took place in February of this year, where Tim, who's here tonight, and myself, and Richard Joyce, who lives in Canada and unfortunately couldn't be here tonight, Adele, who is here tonight, and Victor Bosco, who's here represented by his partner, Cheryl Parker, tonight. And thank you so much for coming down from Queensland, Cheryl. Next slide, please. So in February this year, we had a very significant ball called the Hearts of Valour Ball in our nation's capital in Canberra. For the first time ever, all the Cross of Valour recipients, all the Victoria Cross recipients, the living George Cross recipient, Mr. Michael Pratt, and Corporal Cameron Baird, the last Australian to be awarded, tragically, posthumously, the Victoria Cross. His dad was there to represent his son, Cameron. Ray was the MC for the night, and he captured something that we will treasure as a memory. Now, at this ball, we met this fantastic Greek chap called George Petrou. And George came up and introduced himself, as he often does, and he said, "Oh, I'd like to introduce myself and tell you a little bit about myself and what I do, and perhaps talk to you about something that I would like to contemplate doing." And I said, "Fantastic, George, let's have a beer and talk about it." So we did, and he explained who he was and that he had painted some of the Victoria Cross recipients, including Keith Payne, whose portrait appears at the back. And he said, I would like to paint the Cross of Valour recipients. When somebody says they want to paint your portrait, I'm not sure how you're supposed to react, and I really didn't know how to react. But this was something that I discussed with my fellow recipients. They did, this acclaimed artist wants to paint our portraits. We're all going a bit, oh, bloody hell, what's that mean? And then we sat down and we analysed what a gift was going to be given to us and what an honour was going to be given to us and our families. So that's where the relationship started. And from that, our association between ourselves is growing and growing. And what our role is as Cross of Valour recipients is not to portray what we have done, but our role is to continue the history of Australian men like you are seeing tonight. And that is men who are prepared to die for their fellow man, men who are prepared to give everything because they care so much about their fellow Australians. And that's the essential part about what Australian people are all about, is their level of care. And our role as recipients of these awards is to inspire all of us Australians to care more for each other. Tragically, our Western society has gone down a path of losing the desire to care for each other. We've become very selfish, very insular. But we have to reignite the core sense of being an Australian, and that is caring for your mates. So for us to be here tonight and to be honoured in the way that we have, is a first stepping stone in using these sorts of functions to reignite the Australian spirit that has been given to us through the generations of men before us who have been prepared to die for their country and die for their fellow man. And for that, we are eternally grateful, and I cannot thank you enough. So much. Thank you.
So the first chap that we're going to call up is Daryl Tree. Was awarded the first Cross of Valour in 1989. On the 14th of August 1988, Mr. Petrou placed his life in danger repeatedly to save a 3-year-old boy from electrocution. Mr. Petrou was himself electrocuted multiple times. Did I hear Alan say you died in prison?
I was electrocuted. experience of life, because one of the figures that includes roads and 20-hour cruises at my limit, and I've thought I can't die here.
Well, mate,
that is a really lack of engineering.
It's my great pleasure to introduce you to your portrait. You want me to do them one by one? Sure, yeah, no problem. It's a beauty. Now, would you like me to keep them all up on stage, George? Is that the idea? Okay, no problem. Yeah, sure. Okay, the next guy, and he's not with us just yet, hopefully he'll turn up later in the evening, is Victor Bosco, CB, and his partner Cheryl Parker is going to come up on stage and
accept. I'll get head on. We'll keep us together.
Victor's sitting right on the feed. Oh, terrific, I'd love to meet him. So Victor CD received the Cross of Valour following his heroic actions on the morning of the 1st of September 1993. He risked his life repetitively in pursuing two armed men when he witnessed them fleeing from the scene of a robbery. He continued to follow these men even when having multiple shots fired at them. Thanks to Mr. Bosco, the police were given a detailed description of these armed robbers, which greatly assisted in the conviction of the principal offender.
You can be colourful if you like, Cheryl.
And of course, our next guest is Alan Sparks, CB. Where's Alan? Oh, right there. It's fascinating when I read what Alan did. I remember reading about this at the time and thinking, what a foolhardy thing to do. In the morning of the 3rd of May, 1996, following extreme rainfalls in Cox Harbour, Mr. Alan Sparks and a colleague responded to an urgent call for assistance to rescue a boy trapped in a flooded underground stormwater drain. Come on up, mate. Due to the strength of the current and the lack of light, Mr. Sparks was forced to sacrifice his own safety to find and rescue the young boy. You might have seen the TV vision. I think they tied a rope around you or something, didn't they? He basically plunged himself into torrential stormwater and went into a drain blind.
Yeah, we could hear the child scream, so myself and my workmate and co-mate went into the risk of it. I think at any point we could hear those screams and don't see anything.
This is the most incredible vision, though, of you after you came on. It's says a lot.
Thanks, sir.
Yes. Thank you.
It's the cult of Valour here right behind me. I don't know how I joined that club, but it would be amazing if I could. But all amazing stories. Look, George's story is amazing. And that's how we kind of got involved here. My brother Terry, who's over there, chairman of Findex, was himself involved in a Gallipoli fundraiser to raise a statue in honour of Anzac nurses, who everybody forgets about, right? So that statue has now been commemorated in Melbourne, in Port Melbourne, actually. Life-size bronze statue, significant fundraising effort. And through that we met George, and here we are tonight, honouring all of these people and these stories, and Ross's story of a labour of love, an obsessive desire to name everybody in those photos. And I dare say that's going to be a lifelong journey for Ross to do that, because he's not going to let go, is he, as we know. A very impressive body of work from everybody here, and George for bringing all of those images to life for us to visualise and have some feeling for what they experienced, and all of the worthy winners behind me who in their own way expressed the bravery that they did to be awarded with their medals.
You know, what I especially love about what George has done here is he's put the spotlight on these five men again. And when I first met them, they've become better, but they really are humble men, and they don't like to be in the spotlight. And to paint their portraits means they're special. Now, we know they're really special. That's what George has now made them special forevermore. But to see them here tonight, to be a bit embarrassed by all this attention, and yet they deserve the attention. The point of why George did it was because these are special men, and all five of them. And we should recognise them. And to recognise them in a beautiful portrait, and a really telling, very, especially I think these three and Alan I know so well, Alan Sparks. I mean, he's got the man. He really has got. He's got inside his head. And here's a man who smiles deeply and loves people, and that's what he's got. And you know, this guy Daryl was he was the first, and he was the shyest of lot. For us to try and get him on television was really like, you know, drawing teeth from a chook. They don't have them, and he had no confidence at all. But looking at him today he was able to stand up here and acknowledge the fact that people now recognise him for what he is and who he is. He's a hero. So I just think what George has done is fantastic. To recognise these amazing blokes, and they're really ordinary, amazing blokes, and that's why they're special.
Hi, I'm Al Sparks, and as you can see, this is my portrait behind me, and it's very hard to describe how much of an honour it is to have your portrait painted, and how humble I am to be involved in this whole program. It is simply exceptional, and everybody has to be rightfully proud for being involved in this program.
George Petrou has painted my portrait, and I don't think I've ever been honoured this way before. I contacted George, he asked me if I'd come and do a sitting, and my grandmother, who's now passed away, she left me all her art supplies. She was a budding painter. In all honesty, Nan, I'm sorry, but she wasn't very good, but she passed everything on to me, and George allowed me to bring down these paintbrushes, and we actually used them to paint some of the paint on the painting. And George, honestly, mate, to be included in this tonight has been, honestly, it's one of the highlights of my life. I'm incredibly humbled, touched, and I'm telling you, I don't know what to say. Thank you very much, mate. Just for one day.